this call, and I don't feel much like revival right this second, but I think here in a few minutes, business is gonna pick up. Once the Lord shows up, he knows how to get the job done. Well, I sought the Lord on what he wanted me to preach, and this scripture came to my mind. Hope y'all don't mind if I take my coat off. I can't preach with the coat on. And this scripture came to my mind over in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. I'm sure most of you are very astute on it, and I'm sure you've studied it. Some time back, I guess it was last year, I took about 8 months or 9 months, I don't know, it took a long time. And I outlined every verse on the book of Romans, every verse. And it took months and months and months. So when the Lord put this scripture on my mind, I went back to my notes. And I went back, and this is where I got this from. And this kind of goes along with what we were talking about last night, and how glorious heaven's going to be. And praise God, heaven's going to be a glorious place. Amen?
Amen.
No, we ain't there yet. We still down here. So there's things down here that we have to stay focused on. You don't have to worry about the future, church. Listen to me. Jesus already took care of the future for us. When we accepted him, we accepted eternity with him. Amen?
Amen?
So we don't have to worry about tomorrow. We don't have to worry about what the future holds. We don't have to worry about retirement, because this world, our retirement's out of this world. Amen?
Amen.
Hey, a lot of people talk about 401ks and retirement and what they're going to do when they retire. Hey, there ain't no retirement for Christians. Christians, you might go a little bit slower than you used to, but you're still moving for the same reason, and that's the cause of Christ. Amen. As long as you got breath in your body, as long as you got a Bible and you're clothed in your right mind, God's called us to service, to serve him until we die. Amen. Before you came over here, because you got your amens going. Hey! That's good. Ain't it good? Don't it make you feel all good all over to say amen out loud?
Amen.
You get to know holding those goosebumps. Hey! We're the king's kids. We ought to be happy. And I'm just kind of picking up a continuation of what I was talking about last night. Hey! We're living underneath our privileges as who we are. Huh? You believe that? We are. We get too caught up in what's going on and not caught up enough in who we are. I'll tell you something. Once you get caught up in who you are and you meditate upon who you are, whose you are, and where you're going, that supersedes anything else that's coming against us. Amen. That's why I don't watch the news. If I want to know something's true, I go dial in the JESUS. I spelled it wrong the other night. When we got in the car, my wife said, "You spelled Jesus wrong." And I saw a sister over here about dropped her pen. She's like, I know what she was thinking. But hey, that's just my humanistic side, okay? I'm prone to make mistakes. My wife knows that. She don't make any, though. I'm covering that up right off the bat. Hello! But y'all know what I'm talking about. We got to get tuned into Jesus. And long after these meetings are over with, we still have to get up day to day and walk by faith and not by sight and keep trusting in something we can't see. But hey, when Jesus lives on the inside of you, it's not about seeing him, it's about knowing him. And if you know him, you don't have to see him because he lives in you. And that's all the proof that you need. And you know what? We're all walking, talking examples of the power of God. Because each person who's been touched by the power of Almighty God is a walking example of an unseen hand and a saved soul that rests down and pulled him out of darkness and brought him to the marvelous light. We're all walking examples. That's why we're supposed to let our light shine. We're not supposed to hide them out around with the darkness. We're not supposed to do what the lost people do. There's a difference between being saved and being lost. You know what that is? It's called the power of God.
Yeah, yeah.
Huh? The power of Almighty God. Amen. That's what it is. And if it's in you, it's going to manifest out of you, because that's the way it works. People say, "Well, I don't know if I'm saved or not." Hey, if something as big as God comes out of the inside of you through the form of the Holy Spirit, you'll know it. Who can testify to that? Get your amen-ers on. Say amen.
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 All right, business is picking up. I'm starting to feel better already. I've been feeling bad all day. And then we got on the interstate, you know. until we drove about 25 minutes or 2 miles, not even, you know. And the old devil's like, boy, you ain't never gonna get there. I said, shut up, devil, I'm gonna get there. The devil's always out to hinder you. Any way he can. Any time he gets an opportunity. You gotta watch who you hang around with, and you gotta watch who you listen to. And some people will give you good advice, but I'm gonna tell you something. If it ain't coming out of here, it ain't good advice. Amen. And if it goes against this and contrary to what you believe, then get away from it. The Bible says, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We can't afford to hang around with a bunch of people who don't believe the Bible. Because it looks bad on us, number one. Hey, you ain't going to go do what lost people are doing in Chainsville. They're going to change you. You take a stand away from what they're doing, and you keep living over here in the light, and you keep praying for them, and sooner or later the Spirit of God will touch them and draw them out of that darkness and bring them into the glorious light. That's what we're supposed to do. Don't plunge in there with them. Just stand back from them. It's the power of God unto salvation. And whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You agree with that? God is in the saving business. He ain't looking for anybody for what you got and what you don't have. All he requires from us is one thing. Faith. Faith in Jesus Christ. That's what he requires. I was going to ask for water, but y'all take real good care of me. If you start feeding me, I'll never leave. Stand for the reading of God's word. We'll try not to keep it too late. But hold me on that promise. I'll just keep going until God tells me to quit. How's that? Amen?
Amen.
Well, see, y'all are in a revival, though. Most Baptists wouldn't have said nothing. The Lord, he ain't going to preach for another hour, is he? Romans chapter 5 verse 1 says this, therefore being justified by faith we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we glory in tribulation, also knowing that tribulation worketh patience, patience experience, and experience hope, and hope is not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which he has given unto us. God, sit down. Thank you for standing and reading God's word. And then these verses, I guess, if I was going to put it up to it, it would be why true believers can rejoice. And you know what? We ought to be rejoicing much. You know, we talked about a lot of some of this stuff last night, even though this is going to be a little bit different. You know, when we were here last night, we were sitting back here talking to a sister from Franklin Road Baptist Church, and all I heard was chatter and laughter. And people rejoicing and people fellowshipping. The world don't have that. The world doesn't have what you have. That's why the Bible says, forsake not the assembling yourselves together as a habit of some is. God wants us to come to church. Because you know when you come to church, he meets us here. Huh? And we draw off each other's strengths. And we draw off each other's faiths. Because the older saints are helping the younger saints. Because they've already fought more battles, and they've been married longer, and they've been through these trials and these tribulations, and they're still standing, and they're still smiling, and they're still married. You know what that is, my friend? That's the power of God in their lives. They didn't throw in the towel. When you get married, young people, it ain't, well, if it don't work out, looky here, hoss, it ain't, if it won't work out, you stay married to your wife. Amen. Amen. God forgives and God forgets. But if we can, any way possible, we got to stay faithful. We got to stay faithful one to another. That's our victory. That's our testimony to a lost and dying world. We're faithful. Amen?
Amen.
We're faithful. We're going to be faithful to the Lord. We're going to be faithful to the house of God. That's all people see us Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. I'm not complaining about it. I wouldn't change one iota. And I've never got up on a Wednesday and went to church where I didn't get blessed and wish I didn't go, no matter how tired I am. God blesses you for serving him. There's blessings. and bless you so many different ways, you won't even know how to contain it. But you'll be having a good time trying to sort it all out. I'm telling you, God's good. He's been so good to me. Christians, you need to fully understand the eternal truths, what we have in Christ. Amen? And that little quotation in Christ here, in the epistles alone, is listed right over 100 times. In Christ, or Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's a terminology that the Apostle Paul was using, and he used it in the sense to know. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. It ain't being a Baptist is your hope of glory. Amen? It ain't being a good person or doing good works is your hope of glory. It's Christ in you is the hope of glory. And if you ain't, he doesn't possess you, and if he doesn't live in you, then you're none of his. According to Romans chapter 8, verses 9 and 16, Christ has to come in. In other words, you got to be born again. Amen?
Amen.
Y'all believe that?
Yeah.
See, a lot of people don't know that. Some of the things I'm going to say tonight, some of y'all might not know. But I feel God leading me to more instruct tonight, to go along with what I preached last night, to kind of build you up in the faith. Because right now you don't have a pastor in you. You're seeking a pastor, and that's your weakest moments. That's when all Satan comes up like a roaring lion. Roaring. Trying to defeat you, trying to get you to give up. Listen to me. Don't you glad that Jesus, when he was carrying that cross, oh God, God was him. He didn't get tired and gave up. He went all the way for you, brother and sisters. And he went all the way for me. And praise God, by the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, we ought to give him everything we've got. Because he's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be worshipped. He's worthy to tell people that you're a follower of his. I'm not ashamed of him. You're one of them closet Christians, are you? Huh? You love Jesus? You want the world to know who you're identifying with. Hey, if he lives in you, you ought to be identifying with him each and every day. And your life should be speaking so loud that people ain't even listening to what you're saying. They're looking to see how you're living. They're looking to see. Now, I'm not talking about sinless perfection, because we have the same soul, same spirit, living in an unredeemed body. And that's where the power comes in, and that's where the struggle comes in. It's like this old missionary. He went up there on an Indian reservation, and they led this old Indian to the Lord. And they came back about a year later, and they asked this old Indian. They said, how are you doing with your Christian walk, brother? He said, well, it's like a white dog and a black dog. He said, what do you mean? He said, well, it depends on which one you feed the most is which one wins the fight. And so as it is with our Christian walk. If you reap to the flesh, you'll reap from the flesh. But if you walk in the Spirit, God will empower you to have victory over this life and everything that's coming against you. Listen to me. God tells us a lot of different things in that book, but he never tells us one thing that we can't do, that he's not there to enable us and empower us and equipping us to do it. Amen? He's with us every step of the way, every step of the way. Once the Holy Spirit of God seals you and enters your being, he's with you for eternity. You ain't getting ready.
Yeah.
You hear these old boys, they'll be preaching.
If you just hold on to Jesus.
Jesus is holding on to you. Huh? Yeah. Hey, if it was up to us to keep anything, we would lose it. We can't even find our car keys half the time. How in the world can we keep our salvation? Think about that. We're always losing stuff. Where's my car keys? I don't know if you get there. Where's my checkbook? Who are you? You know what I mean? We can't keep anything. You know, and most of us don't obey the law when we're driving. I wasn't on the way over here. I was doing about 85. I think she'd be with the 70. Huh? Maybe 90. I don't know. Maybe Tony was slowing down. All right, let's get serious now. So these verses give us a deeper understanding of the benefits of what we possess. Every believer has the right to praise the Lord. 1 Peter 1:8, the last part of that verse, the verse says, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. And one of these days, we're going to make it to that celestial city. And one of these days, that's going to be our position in heaven. But right now, we're positioned and we're saved and we're headed there. But there's some things we need to understand while we're living down here to help us get through over there. Because Satan is not going to leave you alone. He's going to keep coming at you. He's going to keep attacking you. He's going to keep lying to you. He's going to do anything he can to try to defeat you. Since the day I got saved until the day I surrendered to preach in a revival, Satan has been on me viciously. He don't back up. He's relentless. I'm waiting for him any time now to attack. Probably when the revival's over. He's coming at me. He's going to hit me with everything he's got. Because I know where he's going, and I know where I'm going, and they're two separate places. And after our victory, Satan ain't going to be up there with his brothers. We ain't going to have to worry about ISIS and all this stuff that's going on down here. It ain't going to heaven unless he gets blood washed and born again and cleansed by the blood of Christ. Ain't no murders going to be in heaven, Austin. God ain't going to have it. See, every believer has to recognize the Lord. There ain't no little believers and big believers. We're all baptized into the body of the Holy Spirit according to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13. So first of all, first thing I see is our position as believers. And this position will never change. And our position declared, look at it, verse 1, chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith. Justified meaning to count someone righteous, to reckon, to look upon him as righteous. And I've probably been saying this every night, and I'm going to keep saying it. When we get born again, God gives us his righteousness because we don't have any of our own. Huh? A lot of people think that they can do good works and they're going to accredit being worthy going to heaven by what they're doing. But the Bible says over in Isaiah 66, all that we do is filthy rags. So everything we're doing, trying to appease God to make it right for us to be saved, all we're doing is making a bigger pile of rags. Heaven, that's all we're doing. We can't do anything to please God except receive his Son and walk in his power. That's it. If we don't have his power in us, we're doomed. We're doomed. Why do you think people will start coming to church and just, they won't come to church no more? Think about that. The Holy Spirit of God most likely don't live on the inside of them. That's not every case, but that's the majority of it. They didn't have a conversion. They did something, a middle access. Well, you know, I believe in God, or, you know, I believe in good works. When we went out to the restaurant Sunday, I asked that waitress, I said, didn't you get to go to church today, huh? Well, I really don't go. I said, why don't you go? Well, I don't know, I'm looking for church. I said, let me ask you something. I said, do you know Jesus Christ, the person, the Lord, and Savior? Do you want to go to heaven? She says, yeah, I want to go to heaven. I gave her a tract, and it's got the gospel in there. How do you say? I said, go ahead and read that. See, that's what I'm talking about. Everywhere we go, we need to be spreading seeds. We need to be leaving God's word. You know what I'll do? When I go to a restaurant, they got a list. And don't ever tell me that you've seen one, because then I'll know what you're up to. It's all the mixed drinks. All the mixed drinks. You know how you open it up and look at all the mystery. I stick me a tract up in there. Well, if God is working on somebody and they get to that and they open that up, there's going to fall. Evangelists, 100 rounds, old fashioned spirit filled person. Got to do what we call them. Huh? Hey, we don't need intoxicating alcohol to feel good about who we are. We ought to feel good already because we've been born again into the family of God. They don't call them spirits for no reason. They are spirits, but they're demonic spirits. They lead you the wrong way. They take you to the wrong crowd. They get you longer than you wanted to go. And you ain't got no business to do it.
Yeah. Well, I believe in drinking.
Well, you go ahead on. And at the end of this thing, you're going to wish you to listen to some bald-headed preacher. Leave alcohol alone. Don't mess with alcohol. It'll ruin your life. It almost ruined mine. But God pulled me out of that hole I was in and set me out of sight of God. And I ain't never messed with it since. And that's almost 30 years ago. That's the power of God, my friend. Took away my desire. It was gone. I tell people all the time, oh, I go to the 12-step program. I said, Hollis, I should save you 11 steps. Come on over here. Let me tell you about Jesus. Let me tell you what he did for me. Huh? Anybody else got that story? Anybody else got that testimony? I'm thinking out tomorrow night doing a real short sermon and letting people get up and give their testimonies to the power of God. What God's done for you. What he's doing for you. Amen? We've all got a testimony. We're walking testimonies. I mean, if you don't know God, why are you in here? If you don't know Him, you're looking for Him, and if you're looking for Him, I can introduce you to Him. Huh? Yeah, I can. See, so this is the way God sees us. We're justified. He sees us completely righteous. Look at Romans chapter 3, verses 21 and 22. He said, Romans chapter 3, verses 21 and 22. It says, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifest, being witnessed by the law of the prophets. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there's no difference. That blows Calvinism, hyper-Calvinism, then out the window, just that one verse. Listen to it. It said, faith, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe. There is no, Christ only died for a remnant. Christ died for the sins of this whole world. There ain't a person anywhere that can't be born again. If they'll bring their faith to God, He'll save their soul and change it right then and there on the spot. Amen. I believe Charles Manson got born again. You can let that nutcase out of heaven and he wouldn't bother anybody. He's possessed, man. He's got a devil. That's his problem. Our prescription, our position described. Looking back at verse 5:1, it says, by faith. You justify how? By faith. That's why it's by faith. And we all just about can quote second. Ephesians 2. By faith through grace are you saved. And that out of yourself is a gift of God. Faith is a gift of God. Jesus was the love of God. The resurrection was the power of God. Amen. Don't forget that. Hey, a dead Savior can't save anybody. If he lay in the grave, he could have never done anything for us. But because he lives, he's done everything for us.
Amen.
Yeah, everything.
Amen.
Everything. All we got to do is just go along for the ride. He's the pilot.
Amen.
You know, don't come up to me and say, well, I don't believe in this Lordship salvation. Jesus ain't my Lord. If He ain't your Lord, He ain't your Savior.
Amen.
Because we don't make Him Lord. He already is! A lot of people don't like to talk to me. Don't you start bringing all that stuff in. Now, I'll be nice if you don't know things. And if I could help God, I'd be nice. But don't be some old hypocrite over from a church somewhere. Come up to me and start talking all this awful wall stuff, and I know it's a lie. I'm gonna blow it right out of the boat, boys. I'm gonna let it rip. And they ain't gonna like me less when they walk away from me. Don't come telling me lies. Because I got the truth that's sitting right here. And it's called the King James Version of the Bible. And that's all I need. I don't need another version. All I need is the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Our position described is by faith. Also in the latter part of verse 1, going over to verse 2, we see our possessions as believers. We see the benefits of justification. And these are the things that we need to meditate on night and day. This is what we are. This is who we are. Huh? These are our benefits of justification. Being made righteous. Being acquitted of all sin. Being declared righteous by God Almighty. We should meditate upon these. This is our victory, church. This is our victory right here. Listen to what I'm saying to you. We need to understand these things. We need to know these things. And we need to walk every day in these things. That's where the victory is coming from. Huh? Because the devil's not going to leave you alone. And in case you hadn't noticed, people don't like Christians too much anymore. You understand that? And people really don't like me. Okay? But you know what? I'm not in a love affair with the world. I'm in a love affair with Jesus. And if I can help this world see Him and what I'm doing, then so be it. I don't care if people like me or if they don't like me. He's accepted me and made a way for me and died for me and saved my soul. He wants to prepare a place for me. And one day soon, He's going to bring me there. My faith is in Him. My faith is in Him. I don't care what Al Sharpton says. If y'all think Al Sharpton is an ordained minister, a man of God, I'm a Cherokee Indian. That old rough baby, he ain't nothing but, he stares up trouble on every corner. Man, you can let certain people go into a town and tear the whole thing apart. Al don't say zip. You let another certain person do something to another certain person, and here he comes with his hands stuck out. He's manipulating his own people. You think Al Sharpton cares about his own people? If he did, if y'all just break it up, stop doing what they're doing. Talking about racial profiling. I heard this one cop say, well, if y'all stop breaking the law, then we wouldn't be arresting you. Hello? Yeah, I'm not being prejudiced. I'm not prejudiced. I preach in all black churches. She goes with me. We the only hunkies in the group. You know what I'm saying? We it. And I grew up like that. I grew up on the south side of Chicago. I had a lot of black friends. I feel comfortable in those churches. You know, I get a little excited too when I preach and they like that. You don't think black people be excited in church, do you? So we see the benefits of justification. We should live upon them daily. Look in the latter part of verse 1. We possess acceptance. Look at that. Look how we're accepted in verse 1. We have peace with God. Now, you go back in the Jewish times, the Paul's times, and those Judaizers were reading this, they couldn't get a hold of that. Because one thing they've been taught since they were birthed, you can't approach God. God is an unapproachable God. Okay? But they didn't understand when Jesus came, the Old Testament passed away. And the New Testament came in. And what the Apostle Paul was doing, he was bringing Jew and Gentile to make one new man, to establish the church of the living God. Now it doesn't matter what you are. It doesn't matter if you're Jew or Gentile or black or white or rich or poor. God loves everybody. And he wants to save everybody. And he has no favorites. He loves us all the same. You can say, you don't know what I was doing last night. I'm telling you, I don't care what you were doing last night. God can save you and change you right now.
Amen.
If you'll let him. Right now. They're talking about that lady in Kentucky. Man, she was. Preachers are doing this. She was married four times before she was saved. God has forgiven her for that. What are you doing bringing up something God don't remember on? You in sin, son. You the problem. Shut your mouth and pray for the sister. To these people who are doing that. Well, she did that. Hey, ain't we all got something to be ashamed of before we were saved? Ain't you glad, Hoss, if you got saved at 25 or 30, ain't you glad that God don't remember what you used to do?
Amen.
Amen. See, that's what we have to use biblical knowledge. That's what we have to realize when to listen and when to talk. You don't attack somebody for what they did back in the day before they were saved. Sinners do what sinners do. Sinners sin. Because that's their nature. And until they get born again and washed in the blood of Jesus and changed by the power of Almighty God, that's what they're going to continue to do. But us, the children of God and the power of God, has been delivered from the lifestyle of that. And we no longer want to sin. We're bent toward holiness and righteousness and walking with the Lord. Coming to church and singing and praising his holy name. Why is that? Because we're saved. That's why.
Amen.
We're saved. That's why we're doing here. That's what you're doing here. Because you love Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We have peace with God. All because you have peace with God. You have the peace of God. Love, joy, peace, long suffering. We have what this world can't buy. We have what Hollywood, with all their money, with all their glitter, wish they could have. In a big 30,000 square foot house. They don't have peace. They don't have joy. They got stuff. Amen? They got stuff. That's why they can't stay married. Because they can't keep their hands off of other people's wives and other people's husbands. They need the power of God in their lives.
Amen.
That's what they need. That's what we all need. You can't do this alone. No devil gets to talking to you. And if you don't have the power of God on you, you don't submit to Jesus, you'll start doing what he's telling you to do. And you're going to bring this stuff to your house and to your doorstep. I ain't living like that. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That's, that right there is time to get your amen or something.
Amen. Amen.
I'm not living like that. You know why? Because I don't have to. And I got good news for you. None of y'all have been either. That's right.
Amen.
Don't worry about what you used to do. Just stay focused on what you're supposed to do. And that's walk with Jesus every day. We have peace with God. Look over there in Romans chapter 5, the 9th verse there. Look at this. Romans 5, 9. Much more now being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. What is he talking about? That's talking about the tribulation period. There's people, man, saying that the church of the living God is going to have to pass through the tribulation period. Why on God's green earth, if we have peace with God, if we've been born again, and he's forgiven us of all our sins, our names are written down in the last book of life from the foundation of the world, why on God's green earth would he take his bride, the righteousness of his own self, and put him through a tribulation period and pour down his wrath upon him? If he did that, he'd have to pour his wrath down upon his son, because where we are, he is too.
Amen.
That ain't going to happen. Hey, Jesus came the first time. That's a lowly land. I got news for your heart. He's coming back the second time like a lively land. I'm the truth, the tribe of Judah. And he's going to ambush the foe. And everybody's going to drop when he speaks. This world's armies are going to die. You can't fight God. And you can't kill God. That's why you couldn't keep him in the tomb. How can you kill the creator of all things? He didn't, you know what he killed him. He laid his life down because he loves you. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. That whosoever what?
Believeth
on him. Yeah. Him. It's him. Praise God. Man, is this good stuff or what? I got worked up writing it down. I thought my legs start tissue. Arms start flipping. Soul starts there. Start feeling better. Sick all day until it's time to come to church. And all of a sudden, I pick up. What is that? That's the power of God. My name's on the sign out there. I gotta come preach. You can laugh. It's okay with it. By faith. You see the benefits of justification. Praise God. Not only are we justified, we possess righteousness and peace with God, but also we possess access. Now this is where it's really starting to get good. Now if y'all want to say amen on this right here, go ahead. We have direct access to God.
Amen.
That means like holding the phone in your hand and something happens and you push emergency 911. Immediately, it rings God's phone. And God knows how to multitask. He can speak to every person he's created. All 7 billion people on this planet. He can listen to them, answer their prayers, heal them, bless them, and save them. All at the same time. That's the power of God, my friend. You got to realize who you're talking about here. You're talking about something who walked out the edge of nothing and spoke to nothing and made something. That's who we're talking about. We're talking about God. God can do anything. There's nothing God can't do. Nothing. And our problems are nothing but little molehills. And you know what he's doing through our problems and circumstances? He's strengthening us and empowering us. So the next time we go through a tribulation, we think, he got me through the last one. He's going to get me through this one. And he will. He will. And people say, well, what if I get sick and die? You're only going to heaven. You don't have to work. You don't have any more birthdays. Women don't have to put up with their husbands. Husbands are always complaining about their wives. If you just shut up and love her husband, she'd be nice to you. Hey, let me tell you a little story about that. My first 8 years of being old Charmaine, man, was just mad. He was going at it. Like, I don't know, dog and cat. I pray. One day I was praying, this is true. I said, help me with this one. You know, God told me the Holy Spirit, he spoke that still, gentle boy. You know what he said to me? I heeded his warning. I took his advice. Now I might think it, but I ain't saying it as much. The thanks are better. I remember.
Hey,
see, boys, women are smarter than you think they are. See, God made man, and he knew he was a wreck. He had to go make him to help me. I used to call her a rib until she didn't find it funny no more. And I stopped all that. No, but I'm being serious. We have to break this as to God. God. And you know what? You know what this word access means? To enter into the presence of the King. In Ephesians, I wrote this down. Ephesians 3:12, it says, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by faith of Him. Now, when you read and study the Bible, you're going to see that little word faith pop up all over the place. Let me read that again. Ephesians 3:12, in whom, in Christ, we have boldness and access with confidence by faith of Him. That's the same thing we're seeing in the text over here, Romans 5:1. It says we're justified by faith. Romans 5:2 says we have access by faith. And Ephesians 3:12 says we have access with confidence by faith of Him. Amen.
Amen.
Ain't that wonderful? Yeah. We have access. Anytime we want to go to God, He'll listen to us. He'll never turn us away. 24/7. Well, I don't want to bother God. You're not bothering God. He loves you more than you love Him. Amen. He wants to fellowship with you more than you want to fellowship with Him. Amen. Amen. It has to be that way. Because if it wasn't that way, He would have never came down.
Sure.
Don't you think God just did what He did to Sodom and Gomorrah? Just said, look at these bunch of people. Man, I'm just going to wipe them all out. God didn't leave us. He desired to fellowship with us. He desired a relationship with us. And once the relationship is intact, the Holy Spirit of God is dwelling on the inside of you, why not just live for Him, be sold out to Him, and let Him use you for His praise and glory? And He's even going to reward you for that. How good is that? God's awesome, folks. I'm telling you what, don't let the flames of revival go out. And I'll tell you this too, I'll throw this out there. If y'all get a bunch of them old funny people coming up in here, sitting around looking all funny, and y'all don't know what to do, call me up. I guarantee you, halfway through that message, they ain't even going to turn around. Amen. That's what the man of God does. The man of God preaches the word of God so people can hear it and get saved. If you don't tell people the truth, how can they get saved? Where is the love in that? You tell me that. People think, well, I don't like that fire and brimstone. This ain't fire and brimstone. In Revelation, when God's blood start coming down, that's fire and brimstone. All preachers are trying to do is get people prepared to get saved so they don't have to endure the fire and brimstone. Don't look at the preacher and get mad at the preacher for telling you the truth, because God Almighty sent him over here because He loves you. Strengthening you through these messages, I hope. He is me. Peace, access. Thirdly, we possess assurance. Huh? Ain't that good? You have assurance. You know that song, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine? The world don't have that, church. Everything I'm talking about tonight, the world does not have. They don't. Not unless they know Jesus. And by large, the world is rejecting Christ. Can the world get saved? Yes. Why isn't everybody saved? In John 5:40, you will not come to me that you may have life. It's a conscious decision. When God sends preachers to you, people come back on your doors, and you witness to people, and you pray for people, and God convicts them and draws them, they won't come. They're making a conscious decision to reject the Savior. And they'll pay the ultimate price for that rejection. That's sad. I wish it wasn't that way, but that's just the way it is. Amen? Because if it's in here, it's true.
Amen.
It's in here. It's in there. Notice the phrase, grace wherein you stand. In verse 2 there, in the text. Grace wherein you stand, meaning the meaning or what is trying to purvey here is permanence of being firmly fixed and immovable. See, when God saved you by grace and brought you into this grace, now we stand in this grace. We don't move in and out of it. That's the position of the believer. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in God, God in Christ, God's in you, Christ is in you. You're eternally one with the Godhead of Almighty God. You're eternally one with the one who spoke this world into existence. You are eternally one with an eternal God that has all power, and nothing can tell Him anything. He does exactly what He wants to do when He wants to do it. Amen? He don't answer to a bunch of Supreme Court justices. He don't answer to Washington, D.C. He don't answer to nobody. He's his own boss. He's a subcontractor. He's God.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That's who we have. That's who we're in. That's who we have access to. That's who we have peace in. And that's why we have assurance. Because now he lives in us. And when he lives in us, church, you got assurance. Praise God. Secondly, assurance hereafter. We will one day be with the Lord. We talked about that last night. We saw the ties in perfectly with the raps last night. And I know the Lord wanted me to preach that, but the songs that you all sung last night, it all just went perfect together. God is in control. I didn't know I was going to do this until today. This was in my mind, but I didn't know yet. I've got sermons laying all over my desk, and all up on the bulletin board. I'm driving down the street one day over to Murfreesboro. God started talking to me. I'm writing down some points, you know. He gives me these points when I'm driving. And I pull up this intersection, and I drive, and I saw the light turn. And I turned on the left on Broad Street over to Murfreesboro, and there's a couple of motorcycle cops. They pulled me over. I said, well, it was a yellow, you know. He said, well, you should have backed up. This is a dangerous corner. I said, okay, license, registration. Well, he was doing what he was doing. I was still writing what God was giving me. Okay? And then he came back and said, okay, I'll give you a warning. I was still writing. I said, okay, thank you, officer. And I kept riding through and driving to him. I said, thank you, Jesus. For not getting the ticket, give me another sermon. That's a true story. Jesus talks to me all the time. And then, you know, it's wild. Don't he talk to you?
Yeah.
Okay. About losing the voice. But that's all right. We'll get through. Okay, now verses 3 through 5. We're coming in for a landing. Now, that ain't the time to say amen right there. Our privileges as believers. We live in a world full of trials and tribulations. Am I the only one who ever has a bad day here? Don't we all go through it? Isn't it multiplying? It's getting more, it's pressing in on us from all sides. And now you know what I heard about that? Miss Davis in Kentucky. Now she's suing the state of Kentucky. You know what? The time God gets sued working the people over in Kentucky, they ain't gonna put another Christian in jail for not issuing those same-sex laws. She ain't gonna need that job. I'm gonna tell you something. God's gonna give her some money for what she did. God delivered her, and God's gonna bless her for taking a stand.
Amen.
And the whole world saying, even the Christian world, well, she, you know, that's her job. No, it's not her job. Her job is to obey God. I love to obey God.
Amen.
Amen. Not man. And that's some unholy thing. All that's going to a pit one day. It's slimy filled. It's all of this church. And if y'all got people who live in that lifestyle, pray for them. Pray for them. Pray for them. But you can't allow all that stuff to infiltrate the schools and the churches. They teach these young kids all that stuff. That ain't right. That ain't right. That's what they want to do. Let them do it. That's righteous indignation. And I'm mad about it. Our privilege as believers. We got the ability to rejoice in troubles. Look over there in verse 3. In verse 3 it says, and not only so, but we glory in tribulations, also knowing the tribulations work with patience. Despite the problems we face, he promises to work it out for us. We get over here in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. Now this verse says exactly what it means. Because I've seen him do this in my life, and you've seen him do this in your life. Especially if you've been married for a long time. There's a reason, church, why people stay married for a long time. Because God works things out. There's a reason why you got healed. God wasn't done with you. God works things out. Amen. It's a supernatural work of God. We can't put it in a corner. We can't take credit for it. It's just God doing what God does. If he said it, he'll do it. Amen.
Amen.
So we got to believe it. It's faith. It all comes from faith. Listen to Romans 8:28. For we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and to them who are called according to his purpose. See, he has a purpose in us. Then also we see the ability to rest in our troubles. And that's by the power of the Holy Spirit. Look back up there in verse 5. It says, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. That's the eternal part of us. You see, right now, we couldn't go to heaven in a flesh and body. That's why we're in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it says, flesh and blood cannot enter into the kingdom of God. This flesh is unredeemed. This flesh is still sinful. But God's got a plan one day. He's going to take this sinful flesh and he's going to glorify it. He's going to take that saved soul and spirit and he's going to put it in that glorified body. And he's going to take us and bring us up to glory. And then we're going to be saved spirit, soul, and body. And then we're going to have our jumping shoes on. And then we're going to praise him for all eternity. And then you're going to be yelling and screaming and praising his holy name. And his glory is going to light up heaven. Just think about how wonderful and beautiful heaven is, church. With all those golden streets and all those precious jewels. With all his glory reading, beating, and radiating off that, off the walls of all those jewels and all the sparkles. And his account of glory is going to fill you and permeate you forever. He's here right now, and he's waiting for you. That's why he sent me.